The dance studio in the SETU College Street campus is starkly lit and uninspiring. It is the backdrop for a collaboration that is, by contrast, boldly and beautifully lit with the many colours of possibility. And as we meet one another, we are reminded that we speak both different and common languages. This room will house some of the preliminary workshops for the Possession Project, an embodied imagining of possession written by the deafened Irish playwright Teresa Deevy, a three-page ballet that has never before been performed. The performance artist Amanda Coogan and theatre practitioners Alvean Jones and Lianne Quigley of Dublin Theatre of the Deaf will join SETU researchers Una Keeley and Kate McCarthy and choreographer Deirdre Grant and their theatre studies students to create a collaborative artwork, and it will challenge and change our conception of what it means to speak and what it means to listen. It is my job to document what unfolds in these spaces. Lyrical Bodies began as a research project that aimed to work with Amanda and Dublin Theatre of the Deaf to explore interpretations of Deevy's work. It required ethical approval at the highest level in our university, deep engagement with considerations of equity and ableism, feminist approaches to teaching and the sharing of research, and a commitment to the challenging of Irish society's framing and treatment of people of various abilities and genders. At the time, these forms were a total nightmare, but eventually, the rigorous ethics process would enable and sustain the many practical and theoretical unfoldings of the project. In April and June 2022, we gather together in this drab room and the group focuses on key scenes: a gratuitous celebration of wealth and possessions, bulls preparing for battle, sombre enactments of death and the devastation of war. This is not a traditional telling, a linear narrative that is absolutely faithful to each word on Deevy's pages. It is something else, something other, something connected with every breath and movement to the body. It is, as Amanda has said of her previous collaborative interpretations of Deevy's work with Dublin Theatre of the Deaf, a shape-shifting. Using digital stories to document this process is a type of shape-shifting too, an attempt to break down boundaries between academia and embodied experiences of the world. I'm nervous. How do I connect the personal reflection element of digital storytelling with the need to objectively tell the story of this research? I try to listen. No longer just with my ears, but with my whole body. The shape-shifting involved in this project is political, and at its heart is defiance. The erasure of women's sign in Ireland's history of deaf culture is well documented, but here it is reinstated to enable us to reconsider the layers of oppression that Deevy's text reveals. The oversimplification of the character of Queen Maeve in the traditional telling of the Thán's cattle raid of Cooley. The underestimation of women's roles in Irish society during Deevy's lifetime in the first half of the 20th century. The invisibility of deaf women in academia and mainstream Irish theatre. In the studio, we are both within and without language. Conversations are had between the deaf and hearing participants and in separate and siloed offshoots, but the workshops and performances are rooted in the common language of the body and the incorporation of women's sign. Over the course of several months and a number of performances of the work in progress, Amanda, Alvean and Lianne return us to the pre-discursive body that is prior to language. But they also explore Deevy's text through the language of women's sign, investigating the spaces that she leaves through ellipses and dashes and the defiant elegiac descriptions that befit the lyrical movement of ballet. We see the world from Maeve's perspective. The horrors of pride and war are revealed through women's sign and movement and via the swathes of fabric that are held with tenderness and represent the dead. Amanda's approach is not to relay every beat of the action on stage, but rather to encourage hints, motions, feelings and snapshots through embodied practice. Here, she shows the group the women's sign for beautiful and how it is elongated and more expressive than the dominant male sign for the same word. Alvean moves to demonstrate it to the students, and this is translated by Ella Chichoka, while Lianne and Amanda converse through sign language and physical movement to progress the scene. This is what Sarah Ahmed calls feminist practice, in which activism and feminist methodologies meet. Una and Kate weave this ethic into all of their research, and they commit again and again to the imperative for scholarly work to engage in activism and to connect authentically with the outside world, as Pierre Bourdieu would have us do. It strikes me as I document and reflect later that the digital stories also bear a duty to reveal these moments that are otherwise ephemeral, and that foreground deaf culture, women's experience, and women's sign in action. They might in another project remain among the academic pages of a journal, described and never seen by those who merely read about it.
They're having a whole conversation, but the deafblind person has to hold the hands to feel the shapes. So that's kind of the part of where that came from. Don't ask me when.
The visual metaphor of the unfolding fabric is central to the ethics of this project. When I watch it through my lens, it is colourful and beautiful, yet deeply symbolic and sombre. I see promising students, accomplished academics and award-winning theatre practitioners moving together as equals, to give body to Deevy's ballet. The fabric is solidly anchored to the wall, just as the ethics of the project are deeply embedded, and this is what enables the rich unfolding to take place. I watch, and I listen, and I feel the importance of what Deevy has left us.